Hyena Culture is a space aimed to give access to underrepresented groups in Seattle performing arts. This event space for small businesses provides a unique experience through workshops and classes. For more information, visit hyenaculture.com. 4Culture is one of the biggest organizations providing funding for cultural work that keeps King County vibrant. For more information, visit 4culture.org. What's up, everybody? Welcome to Season 3 of the No Blueprint Podcast. I'm your host, Dominique Meeks. You could have been anywhere in the world, but you're here with us, and we appreciate that. We're more than honored to bring you our live recording from our August conversation with artist, curator, filmmaker, and activist, Tracy Rector. We hope you enjoy the show.
I'm a mother, a daughter, a wife, and I'm a filmmaker and curator and activist. And this morning, I was humbled to read about the passing of Ms. Toni Morrison. And it really brought me back to high school and the struggles that I experienced in high school, you know, just struggling to survive, basically. And choosing to read The Bluest Dye was a way for me to kind of exercise some of those struggles that I grew up with. And recognizing today that now she's an ancestor, and she's an ancestor that we get to draw upon from her experiences and her wisdom in a different way from when she was with us, you know, on Earth. And it just really made me think about my purpose, because in high school, I became very committed to fighting racism because of her words, thinking about domestic violence because of her stories, and really understand that the system's not just. And here we are today. I'm still fighting those fights, but in different ways and with different compassion, but also with a new kind of fierceness. And I don't know, that's just who I am today, and that's always evolving and that's always changing, but maybe at the core there's always this essence of being an advocate for the people and for community. I did just come back from the Sundance Producers Summit, and it was amazing. And it's incredible to be invited to one of those types of tables. The end note was very interesting, though. Someone came up to me and he said, you know, I kept looking at you the whole time you're here and I just couldn't figure out why you were here, because you don't seem like you possess the qualities of a successful producer.
How did you take that?
He paused and he realized what he said. And I said, wow, that's a very colonized mentality. And he said, but the workshop by Heather Ray, she talked about what real power is. And he said, I realize that you're one of those people because you have an interesting energy about you when you walk in the room. You're not like the rest of us. And again, I was confused. And this is something I've heard my entire life. You're not one of us. You don't belong. So I sit and I understand how to pause and sit and hold with grace this space that's not fair and is unjust and is patriarchal. But he said, you know, something I learned is that real power is about being connected to the earth and to humanity. And it's not about what we all strive for as producers. And of course, he's including everybody and we all, except for me. You know, we all strive for that ego, that satisfaction, that money of creating these stories, but creating these stories with that capitalist mentality. And he's like, you're not about that. You're about something different, and that's real freedom. So it was a sideways kind of, can we swear?
It was
a sideways, pretty fucked up compliment. And so I just got on my bus and I resolved to hold in my mind that quote by Audre Lorde that says, The master's tools will not dismantle the master's house. And it just further, that comment just furthered my conviction to building new systems. And that's all I've done with Longhouse Media, is through failure and through successes, just built new systems. And especially for Indigenous peoples, you know, we, and for me as a mixed race person, we don't always have the luxury of walking that path of the systems that have been built. And actually, I don't see it as a luxury. I see those as chains that bind people. And all weekend I heard these producers talking about the industry's changing, we're not gonna survive. But you know what? I didn't feel affected by that because I've been walking this path with Longhouse Media of creating our own system.
Absolutely.
Making media for the people, by the people. Mm-hmm. Not caring about selling stories, making money off of stories. Mm-hmm. Telling stories that are authentic and in collaboration and in community. Mm-hmm. And I think that has cushioned me in a way that maybe once felt really tough, but now I feel incredibly privileged. And he was right. There is a certain kind of freedom that I have, because I don't really care about selling stuff. I don't really care about power in that way. Those are tools. Those are certainly tools, but long story. But I want to create new systems, and I'm especially feeling some power around that these days.
And I want to go back to, when did you find out that you wanted to be a storyteller?
Well, I grew up in a pretty disjointed, pretty dysfunctional home, and I was a latchkey kid, and I watched a ton of TV. And I especially loved Wonder Woman and Star Trek. And I remember I was in kindergarten and we had show and tell. And I got out this foil and I made myself Wonder Woman bracelets and a lasso and a crown. And I brought that into my class, and it was confusing for them. And yeah. I thought they did a great job.
Yeah, they didn't understand Wonder Woman?
They didn't understand, no. But what I knew at that moment is I was trying to create a story for myself, and I saw the power in this woman. This woman, fighting the Nazis, being herself, being covert, and having this fantasy life in many ways. So, you know what? I remember living in this fantasy world a lot. And I don't know if I knew then that I was a storyteller, but I knew that there was a different way to share my vision than to have a voice.
That's true. And did you have people around you that didn't take the traditional 9-to-5 path that inspired you to be a creative?
Well, I guess, you know, it's like I started in storytelling. So I used to be a domestic violence worker. And that's really, it's really challenging, especially for someone in their 20s. And there is a point where I just, we had some, you know, women who were murdered by their abusers. Wow. And we had a few break-ins into our shelter, and it just broke me. It broke me spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, and I just realized I had to do something different. I was too sensitive of a person to be on the front lines like that. That's important work. And I tried my best, but in my 20s, I just was not equipped to do it for 6 years. Right. And in that moment, I tried to figure out what else can I do. My neighbor, she ran an herb shop, an apothecary called Dandelion. And she remembers me. I don't remember this. I guess I like stomped up to her house. I was in my combat boots. I was in ripped up like leggings or pajamas and a bustier, and my hair was in pigtails. I don't even remember this.
Like, where was this?
Here in Seattle.
Okay, all right.
I don't know. I was just probably in that fantasy space, and it's almost like I dressed up like a superhero. I don't know, but I walked over there as like, can you help me? And I need a job, and I can't do this anymore. Mm. And so she let me come work at Dandelion, and it was an amazing experience to just be in contact with medicine in that way, and to become more in touch with the spirit world, to think about healing. And it was what I needed to kind of exercise all of the trauma from being in the shelter. Mm. And while I was at Dandelion and just being part of this incredible community, I decided that I wanted to commit myself to practicing medicine, traditional medicine. So I went to the Evergreen State College, and I got hooked up with the Skokomish Nation, and I started working in the garden of Bruce Miller. And at that time, PBS came to do a story about him, and he said, only if you hire a Native intern, because our people need to tell our own stories. And so he put me on that project, and I was like, I know nothing about media. I know nothing about film.
What?
And he's like, but you've talked about working with young people. You talked about working with people who've fallen through the cracks. And this is a perfect way to reach across that divide. And so I said yes. And that was 17 years ago. And my first project was called Teachings of the Tree People. And I just kind of kept going on this path. It's been amazing.
Wow.
And that's how I came to storytelling in this way. It was through herbal medicine.
That's amazing. So then you finish at Evergreen. You go back to do a master's in education?
Mm-hmm. So during this time period, I had two young boys, and I thought if I stopped at Evergreen with my undergrad, because see, I went back to school late. When I was younger, I didn't really have the self-confidence to be in school. I didn't think I could do it. And that's part of the healing work, that being at Dandelion, it helped me to have enough self-confidence to realize that I could do it. Anyhow, but I was also having kids at the same time. And I'm a person who likes challenges. And so I was just trying to do it all at once. And I knew if I stopped, if I didn't just go straight into getting my master's, that I probably wouldn't go back, because it's just how life is, right? So I was on a roll. I decided to go to the Muckleshoot Indian Reservation. They had a program there for philosophy of Native education and a teacher prep program. So I went there, and that's when I started Longhouse Media. That was my thesis project.
Say more.
Yeah. How so?
Say more about starting Longhouse Media. Yeah. Like, what was it in its infancy? And how did you take that idea and really continue to grow it?
So I worked with a filmmaker named Annie Silverstein, and so together we just started building out this program, and we worked at the Swinomish Indian Reservation, at Muckleshoot, and we brought the tools of media production to Native communities, to Native kids, in after-school programs, in-school programs, during breaks. Our philosophy being that so often these programs that are in big cities, they expect that POC communities and young people come into the cities, come outside of their communities to create work or to experience new ways of being or learn new tools. And so our commitment was to go out into the world. And I think I put 200,000 miles on my car in 4 years.
Wow.
Just like driving from res to res. It was amazing. It was an amazing generative time. We just worked our asses off. And we made a lot of mistakes. We made a ton of mistakes, but we had a lot of successes. And through that whole process, we realized that we ourselves, as filmmakers, were becoming better filmmakers because we were working with young people who had just incredible ideas.
Right.
And so it was definitely an exchange, the work that we did. And I would say for the first 10 years of Longhouse Media, it was really primarily focused on working with young people and that exchange of energy and knowledge that happens in that way.
Yeah, that's so awesome. Because I was like, so when did you start working with young people? And it's like, from the beginning.
Yeah.
That's super cool. Who were some of your first supporters?
Yeah, so we had a lot of supporters. Sherman Alexi was one of our founding board members.
Wow.
And mostly women, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of women, lots
yes.
of Native women. Women who've been just holding up the sky for years.
Absolutely.
And they're still holding up the sky.
Absolutely.
Lots of guidance, lots of mentorship. And yeah, we've worked with over 3,000 youth in over 51 different tribal communities. And we always say it's not about us, it's really about the process mm-hmm. and the people in the communities.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I know that in working with as many youth as you've worked with, that mentorship is sort of built in. What are those lessons that you deliver to the youth that you work with?
Mm-hmm. Well, one thing in this work is, I definitely knew from the beginning that I always try to remind myself of, is that this work's about planting seeds.
Mm-hmm.
You may not ever see the fruits of those seeds, but it's about planting seeds.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahout, our show that was at King Street Station that just wrapped this weekend, mm-hmm. The young woman who's our leader in that project, Asia Tail, she was a student of mine in our youth making camp.
Mm-hmm.
And so thinking back about her teenager self all gothed out and not talking, that there was an element in those moments of planting seeds, and then the fruition is this freaking incredible
mm-hmm.
show.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the power that she exudes as a fierce Native woman has just transformed so many people around her.
Mm.
Again, I feel like sometimes I just don't have answers, but sometimes you have to just do the work, one foot in front of the other.
Mm.
Have faith. And if you approach whatever you do with a good heart and good intentions and, you know, just the right frame of mind, that I think, especially with young people, they feel that. They feel the authenticity and that truth.
Mm-hmm.
And they can take that forward in their lives in the way that makes sense for them.
For sure. For sure. You just threw me an alley-oop about the new arts and culture space and the new exhibit. How did that come to fruition? How did you decide who you were going to collaborate with?
So again, Asia Tail, about 3 years ago, I was on the Seattle Arts Commission, and she said, hey, I have this idea for this project. Would you be interested in doing it with me? And I said, yes. I guess that's one thing I've done a lot in my career is just say yes. I'm learning to say no now, but yes has been awesome. So I said yes to Asia, and she also brought on Sapreet Kolon, mm-hmm. who she met at an arts retreat through Centrum.
Nice.
And the three of us just came up with this idea and decided to figure it out with the city. It was not easy,
mm-hmm.
But we decided to figure out and center Indigenous philosophy and voices, specifically guided by Vi Hilbert's story.
Mm-hmm.
Yahout. And knowing that sometimes you have to just proceed forward and do it.
Mm.
And that's how the work came about.
Nice. And you said it just ended?
It just ended. It just wrapped this weekend. 3-year process.
Wow.
Just wrapped. And, you know, we wanted to Yeah, it's over 250 Native artists that we exhibited. And we just wanted to approach the work differently. We went out to communities, we called people up. People kept telling us, you know, it's never going to happen, you're never going to do it, you aren't going to get any submissions. And we said, well, no, it's because if you impose a Western framework on reaching out to artists, all those barriers are going to prevent them from feeling seen and heard and truly wanted. And we wanted to do that in a different way, in a more collaborative, community-driven way. And so, yeah, it kind of blew the city's mind.
Yeah.
I think in many ways they weren't sure if we were going to actually pull it off.
Yeah.
And our opening day, I think we had 3,000 people show up opening day.
That's super awesome.
And it's again, it's all community. You know, it's just the three of us as curators. We were guides. We were guided to do the work, but it was really about doing the work with community, and the community showed up for one another.
That's super awesome. What did you... You said it was a three-year process. What were some of your personal takeaways in working on this project for as long as you have?
Oh man, arts administration is not easy.
Yep.
It's really hard. I mean, there is some beautiful aspects. When things really started heating up at the border last May, we realized that we absolutely had to do a spotlight on Indigenous Latinx artists. And so we did a 3-month specifically curated project at Vermilion Art Gallery in Napantla, also in White Center. And we worked with community coordinator Jessica Ramirez to really do that outreach with community. And that felt so special. And just we knew we were making the right choices, doing the right work, because the community was showing up and we were supporting Jessica and her choices and how to bring community together. The hard stuff though was really about maintaining safe space and really putting out into the world and having to work with artists in a way to acknowledge maybe their challenges, their personal challenges, and how they may have harmed people, and letting them know that we were maintaining a safe space and they couldn't be part of the show if they were not committed to their own personal responsibilities around finding justice with others. That was hard. It was hard to have those conversations. It was hard to take people out of the show if we found out they had harmed people. We had to really think through, you know, what our responsibility is to community, but also just not throw away people who've made bad choices in life and how to negotiate that. And we weren't expecting that at all.
You've been making films and documentaries for 17 years. What excites you at this point in your career?
Well, today I started a new job, a full-time job. I'm a W-2 person now.
Okay. All right.
I haven't done that for 20 years.
Welcome.
I'm excited. It's for an organization called Nia Tero, and the motto is Thriving People, Thriving Places, and it's an organization that supports Indigenous storytelling as a way to protect environment. And that's what we do.
Nice.
And I'm really excited about that. I'm excited to be part of a team and a family, and that there's resources to really help communities and individuals tell stories in the way that they want to.
Nice.
And again, it's just about bringing resources back out into the community. That's what I love.
What did it take for you to say, I'm ready to jump back into a W-2?
It was all kind of a mystery to me. I was...
She's like, what am I signing?
Sure. you know, my name was put forward. I got a call from a guy on the mountaintop in Borneo. Okay. It felt really surreal and odd. But something about it, you know, talk about curiosity. I wanted to follow this. I wanted to understand what they saw in me and to be open to that possibility. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when, like the elder who got me into filmmaking, he saw something in me. Mm-hmm. And he saw that a door opened and presented that option, and I said yes. Mm-hmm. And it felt like that in this moment too. And so 8 interviews later.
8 interviews?
8 interviews later.
Wow.
That made up for all 20 years of not working for anybody. They finally invited me to join the team, and you know, I really took time to think about it and wanted to make sure that this was the best step for not only myself but for my family and the community. And so I said yes.
Nice.
And so I'm really excited.
That's super awesome.
Yep.
And how do you measure success at this point?
Well, sometimes it's just if I wake up in the morning, that's awesome.
Yep. Listen.
You know, things are hard sometimes these days, and so it's sometimes it's important just to be grateful for waking up.
Absolutely.
And so I feel like I'm just kind of getting to back to basics in some ways.
Yeah.
And if in this role, in this new role at Nia Tero, if I can help create a system that will contribute to the liberation of Indigenous peoples and POC peoples, then my life will have been well lived.
Nice. And my last question before we open it up to the audience is a really basic one. A lot of us say that we don't have the time to do this and don't have the time to do that. You seem to be someone who defies all of that. What do you say to that? How do you find the time in the space?
I don't know. There is a while, maybe that first 10 years of Longhouse Media, people kept thinking I was a vampire. I don't know. And that goes back to self-care. I was not living in a sustainable way for a long time.
Okay.
And I'm moving more towards that. But because of those choices, I got a lot done. I mean, what do we use our time for? My husband and I, a couple years ago, we tried this thing for a year. For the first weekend of each month, we had no media whatsoever. No TV, no radio, no phones, no computers, nothing. Oh my God, we got so much done.
I'm sure.
It was amazing. And so I don't know, when people say they don't have time, it's like, look at how you're using your time and look at how collectively we're using our time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that we have a lot of choice.
So I'm curious, what did your family and friends think about your pursuit and not going
You know, I think over the last 17 years, friends and family have been very concerned about me, especially my dad. You know, my dad grew up in deep poverty and really fought his way to not not have his family experience the oppression and trauma from being in such deep poverty. And so I think he especially he still doesn't get me, but he especially did not get me when he knew I was struggling. And And that's real, you know, it's real for POC families, I'd say, who, you know, I'm lucky that my ancestors were hard fighters and survivors, and I'm here because of that. Mm-hmm. And I know he firsthand, especially, was working three jobs and eating bad food just so we can have a place to live. And so I think he worried about me a lot. I know he did. And then I'm grateful to have such amazing friends who I'm sure worried too, but also were very generous and supported me along the way. And I'm just stubborn and hard-headed, so I think sometimes too, people are just like, she's gonna do what she's gonna do, so we'll just let her be. But you know, even my kids a couple times were like, because there'd be often times I wouldn't be paid for a long time, you know, and it was a challenge. There was times, I can't lie, where, you know, our lights were turned off, or we were going to a food bank for a solid 5 years. Mm-hmm. And I was grateful for that, but my kids saw that, and they saw that choice I made, and they're like, Mom, you gotta get paid. You work too hard to not be paid. Mm-hmm. So that was hard. Yeah, it was hard to negotiate in myself what I was doing everything for and how it was impacting my family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, you were gonna answer the...
Oh, your question? Oh, yeah.
Go ahead.
So you mentioned trying to be better about self-care nowadays. Could you share with us like one or two or three self-care habits that you're starting to practice more in your life to take care of yourself better, to make it like sustainable, like health-wise, like mentally and physically, to keep doing what you're that we could maybe do ourselves.
Sure. Or four or five.
Your whole day.
Right. So I'll talk about in recent terms, if that's okay. Sugar Pill up on Capitol Hill, Karen Schwartz, she runs that. Mm-hmm. She makes good medicine. So I recently just went up there and got some ashwagandha tincture that she made up, and just realized that I needed to expand my circle of care in that way. Trying to drink water and breathe deeply. I'm also trying to just speak honestly more so and just be myself. There's ways for a long time where I just kept my feelings to myself, and I feel that bottling up in that way wasn't really serving me well. And then lastly, I really enjoy time with girlfriends and just laughing hard. And I want to do that more this year.
Nice.
That laughter really sustains me in a deep way.
That's so underrated.
Yeah,
it is. So underrated. Yes.
Just surrounding yourself with people that you can be yourself around.
That's right.
Oh, so your question. So I was thinking back to... Bruce Subi Miller from the Skokomish Reservation. The film was called Teachings of the Tree People, and one of the most important teachings was diversity. And diversity, you know, if I could say one thing, is that diversity is important for our survival in all ways, shapes, and form.
Nice. Okay. I'm gonna do a lightning round.
Okay.
Okay. Lightning round. We are going to, let's see how many questions we can get out. Favorite movie?
Around midnight.
Favorite time of day?
Twilight.
Interesting. Favorite color?
Midnight blue.
The most inspiring thing that you get from your kids?
Honesty.
Your favorite gift?
Love.
The best thing that you've bought for under $50 in the last year?
A perfectly ripe mango.
Favorite flower?
Gerber daisy.
Did I ask you the Your favorite place that you've traveled? Okay, that was what I was going for. Favorite place you've traveled?
Morocco.
Wow.
That's an awesome place for a mixed race person.
Least favorite place that you've traveled?
Missouri.
Valid. One thing you can't live without?
My family.
Oh, that was so sweet. Three things that you would pack in a luggage to travel around the world.
Chili dusted dried mangoes. My contact lenses. And rose water tonic.
Favorite accessory?
Earrings.
The best project you've ever worked on?
Is it too cheesy to say my kids? It really feels like that.
That I'll take it.
All right.
I'll take it. Again, you made me lose my train of thought. I was like, she's going to say. Next adventure.
Going to the Amazon.
Wow. That's super awesome.
Yeah.
I think that is all that I have.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It is an honor to be able to hold space with you. I'm honored by the folks that are here today in this live audience that people will hear and not be able to see y'all, but we're on YouTube. And so thank you all for being here. Before I go, I will ask if folks have any more questions. We still have time to hang out and ask questions in person, but any for the sake of the podcast. Okay. Thank you all. Appreciate you. Season 3 of No Blueprint is recorded in front of a live studio audience every first Tuesday at Hyena Culture in the Pioneer Square neighborhood of Seattle, Washington. To find out how you can attend the next show, follow us on social media or on our website at noblueprintpodcast.com. We hope you enjoyed the show.